customers, our listeners, could be hearing about your business right now. Yeah, right now. Don't miss out on the opportunity to advertise with NewOrleansTalkNetwork.com. Call our business department today at 504-475-4793 to hear about our great rates. NewOrleansTalkNetwork.com. We provide the people, you provide the business.
FanView Live, new time, 12 p.m. each and every Thursday on the Walls Talk Network. Join me, that boy Fred.
GSportz in the building.
Coach Herbert can't hit.
Yeah, I'm woke. Elevate.
Ball game.
Yeah, dig.
Yeah, dig.
I just don't understand why in the NFL, when a coordinator has a good year or two good years, we always want to put him up for a head coaching job. And I've been saying this for years, and I said it last week on the show. Everybody not suited to be a head coach. I love Dennis Allen. I love his personality. I think he has done a great job with our defense, even though I think he's getting a little too much credit. I think Ryan Nelson and Chris Richard played a big part in why our defense got better. Because Dennis Allen, his defense in the past has not been this great.
Right.
Okay? They have been average sometimes.
About it, to me, prime, it's only two people that I want outside of Dennis Allen. Eric Bieniemy, Brian Flores. Think it's cut and dry. Those two. I don't want to hear talks about Jim Harbaugh. I don't want to hear talks about nobody else. It's those two guys, period. And if you get Bieniemy, I believe that makes us attractive again to your Aaron Rodgers, to your Russell Wilson's. You know, in that mindset.
This is what looms bad for the Chiefs. And y'all who watch the show, y'all know me. I hate monotony, so I hate seeing the same thing over and over again. I don't want to see the Chiefs in the playoffs. I mean, in the Super Bowl this year. Not to say that they don't deserve it, not because I'm an LSU guy, but it's.
Y'all see GSportz? He gonna hit the shoulders off. You know, you feeling like Hov, huh?
I'm feeling like GSportz.
Welcome, everybody. Welcome to FanView Live. Real fans talk sports only on the Walls Talk Network. Listen, I'm that boy, Fred.
GSportz in the building, back again.
There he is. Y'all already know what time it is. It's the best damn sports show in the goddamn internet. Listen, thank y'all for subscribing. Listen, y'all can tune into us on FanView Live. If you're on our Facebook page, we also have a YouTube page, FanView Live. Don't forget to subscribe to us on Twitter, FanView Live. It's FanView Nola. On Twitter, FanView Live on IG. We're also on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and we're also on Spotify. You can find us there also. My man, Coach Hurricane Hinn, will be joining us also. He'll be on the Zoom call with us for today's episode.
We got so much to get into, so much to discuss. What's going on all around the world of sports? We got National Signing Day yesterday. Much to get into with that, GSportz. Mm-hmm. We got to talk some of the new head coaching hires around the NFL. And that Michigan man decided to call it quits after 22 seasons.
Yep.
Got to talk about that guy over there, you know, in his career that he's had and that GOAT in Tom Brady. But we also got to have a guest caller joining to us, you know, one of the guys who backed him up in New England. One of the former New England Patriots, one of the former LSU Tigers, and Rohan Davey.
will be joining us today on FanView Live. We got so much to get into. Y'all ready to kick this show off? Y'all ready to get it on and popping?
You know it. Let's get it.
What Coach Hurricane Henry? I already know he got something to say. Let's see if Mike, the producer, can get him on in here at some point in time. Y'all can hear us, y'all there? As we got a lot of people already in the chat, you know. My Bengals easily cover the Super Bowl. So much to get into. My man Scoot St. Clair said he in the building. One guy said that the audio is off. So, if producer, if you can get that, say the audio is off. Say you can't hear. It said it sounded like the audio is good. But much to get into. Rohan Davey, are you there? Are you there with us?
I'm here, dog.
There he is.
Ro, man, appreciate you coming on FanView for the first time, man. You know, I kind of been wanting to get you on the show at some point, man, to kind of get your knowledge of what's going on in college football and in the NFL, man. So, you know, appreciate you taking the time to come on FanView, man.
Absolutely, big dog. Ain't no thing. Absolutely. Ready for you.
You know, there's a lot going on right now, man, you know, with LSU's signing day yesterday, the second signing day period. I thought they did a really good job of kind of filling some needs in year one for Brian Kelly. You know, you got Tom Brady retiring, the Super Bowl approaching. Where are you at with it, man, Ro, as it pertains to, you know, you being in that New England Patriots organization, you know, seeing Tom Brady and kind of you was there during that pioneer stage when he kind of got jump-started and kind of was going through that process of coming turning into the GOAT. And what's your take on LSU signing class?
Well, to answer your first question about Tom, it's amazing to me that the consistency that Tom's played with over such a long period of time. You know, we all are affiliated and know about sports. And you know that in order for you to get up every year, every day, especially after you had so much success like he's had, for you to come in every year and find you a new target, new goal, new way to get yourself prepared is unbelievable. We was looking at a stat the other day where Tom's been in the league 22 years, played in 10 Super Bowls, won 7, and has played in 33% of all Super Bowls. You know what I mean? That's crazy, dog. It's similar to, like, I saw a stat with Coach Saban at Alabama. That same recruiting class that he's recruited, they've won a national championship. You come there, you're going to walk away with a national championship. In 4 years, you're going to win a national championship. So stats like that, man, are, like, crazy to me. And the fact that Tom left New England, went to Tampa, won the chip there. It just says a lot, bro. Let me just tell you this. Him and the success that he's had is not an accident. You know, I was fortunate enough to be there with him for a while. Not as long as I would have liked to, of course. But he works his ass off, dude. I mean, he works his behind off, and he's steadily trying to see how to get better. So kudos to him, bro, Great, 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 great Americans not coming back home. You know, LSU's benefited from the transfer portal. The transfer portal has, like you pointed out earlier, it has helped them address some needs, some immediate needs right now, as far as like interior line, some of these backers, some of these running backs, and so on and so forth. The most for me right now with LSU, and it's a big thing everywhere. I think that's part of the reason why A&M was so successful with their class this year. We got to get our NIL situation right, and that's the biggest thing with LSU right now is trying to get that situated, because it's free agency, bro. Like college football and it's open market, it's free agency for these guys, and it's free agency for the guys coming in. It's free agency for the cast that's on your team.
Yep.
You know what I mean? You got to make sure you keep them. So it's helped us, but we got to get our NIL situation straight and be able to go after and target some of these guys that everybody else is going after and be able to put the bread up, you know what I mean, and make sure that everybody gets taken care of. Because with the NIL situation, I think that if we look at it from a standpoint of like, look, G, we all know, like, you know what I'm saying, we come out of situations where we look out for mama. We got to look back. We in school. Half of the Pell Grant go home to mama. You know what I'm saying? You might go buy you some shoes or something, but it's going to the crib. You know what I'm saying? And so if they target the NIL situation right and say, okay, check this out. We're going to get about 10, 15, 20, however many businesses that love the program. You ain't about to get no bread back from it. Yeah, this is just straight. You love the program. You got an M or two that you can put in the pot, put it in the pot. And now these kids that's coming in, you require these kids to do things like community service. Go talk to some high school, read to some kids at an elementary school. Go out in the community and do things of that nature. Then you get your $3,500 a month, you know what I'm saying, through NIL. But don't make it to where the kids are representing, whether it's an attorney or whoever, for that person's own personal gain. That's the part about it to me that, you know, you got to take out. But until we get out in an NIL situation, and I'm talking about get that thing situated as quick as like in the next month or two. Because if that doesn't happen, these same recruits that we have coming in that we're so fond of, and even these guys that we have on the squad, the Mason Smith, the Sage Rosen, for all these guys that's here, that's everybody's knocking at their door. If we don't get that situation straight and get some bread in these boys' pocket, we're going to have a mass exit come spring football, dog.
No doubt.
No doubt. Coach Hina, are you there?
Yeah.
Go ahead with your question, man.
Now, Rohan, unlike my counterparts, those are Michigan guys over there. Me, myself, I'm the only true LSU guy. So, I just got to ask a question. It's something that I always wanted to ask you, man, because a lot of people don't know that you're from Jamaica and stuff. And then, you know, you played your high school ball in Florida. What made you, at the time, leave Florida to come to LSU? Because, you know, the LSU wasn't that hot, you know, under Coach DiNardo and all that stuff.
Right.
And you came in. I want to say, if I remember correctly, you came either in with John David Booty, or you came in like right after him when Herb Tyler was still a quarterback. So what made you come to LSU? One of the greatest games that I ever seen as a fan. I want to say y'all was in Tennessee. I think they was like ranked like top eight or something like that.
Yeah.
But in overtime, man.
Yeah. That was in Tiger Stadium. That was one of my best games too. But to answer your question, man, honestly, at the time in Miami, I was we were getting into like some little trouble. You know what I mean? Like the cast that I grew up around. So not me personally, but just people around me. And so through my affiliation, my mom didn't want me to stay home. My mom wanted me to get out of Florida. And so for me, I always wanted to stay in the SEC. Once I started paying attention to football, I wanted to stay in the SEC. And honestly, dude, I saw LSU playing Florida my junior year, and Herb Tyler was the quarterback. And it was the first SEC school I saw that had a black quarterback. That's really how, like, I first started getting interested in LSU. And then I started paying more attention to him, and then they started recruiting me. And then I came on my recruiting trip. And when I came on my recruiting trip, that shit was over. Honestly, dog, like, the food, the Creole women, it took me to, like, Lafayette. I saw everything out there in Lafayette and saw the surrounding New Orleans. Listen. Yeah, so it was all that, man. The food, the women, the people, the fans that I went to the game, the fans at the game. I had never seen, like, gumbo pots before. I had never seen, like, some, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Just everything right, that I saw. It was great, dude.
Different culture.
The culture was crazy. crazy. It reminded me of Jamaica a little bit, just like with the fanfare.
Yeah.
Everybody walking around, everybody was so hospitable. You know what I mean? You could go anywhere, drink anywhere, eat with anybody. It was just, it was dope.
Now, Rohan,
and it wasn't like that nowhere else.
Right.
What other official visit did you take besides LSU?
I went to Ohio State. I went to Michigan.
Man, why you didn't go to Michigan, man?
Too cold. I understand,
too,
man.
Too damn cold, dog.
That's too cold. I already knew.
It was too cold.
Hell, bro.
Too cold.
It was too cold. I went to Texas, and I took a visit to West Virginia because my head coach he came from West Virginia the last year, so I went to West Virginia on the strength of him.
Gotcha. I had a question for you, Ro.
Yeah.
Just watching the college football game, and you seen the advancement of RPOs. What's your take on how the college football game has changed now that all these schools are now, and all these quarterbacks now, you know, the college game has evolved to being more of an RPO kind of style? What is your take on what you're seeing around?
Man, you're right, bro. You know what it is? It's really just, it's just a fast breaking, like basketball on grass now. It's like basically everything is 7-on-7. They're trying to take the physicality out of the game. And especially at the quarterback position, they're trying to take, because, I mean, those are the guys that sell the tickets. So they're trying to keep those guys scaly, basically unhinged and no stress during the game. And, I mean, I'm a quarterback, so, I appreciate the physical part of the game. I could appreciate them trying to take out, you know, the hits and the roughnecking and stuff like that. But, man, I think it benefits the quarterback in this type of football, especially with what we get involved with, with the 7-on-7 and all that. It just speeds up. It speeds up their mental so much faster than, like, say, when I was playing, because it's no more so much let's just run the ball. Teams now, an extension of the run, like you said, is the RPO, and that's basically just box. You know what I mean? Like, I'm reading one guy. He steps up. I'm pulling. He gets back. I'm popping him. So, I think that it benefits offense tremendously, man, with the way that it has changed football, with just the rules, taking the physicality out of the game, the inception of the RPO. I think it's changed for the better on the offensive side, as far as you want to put up more points, you want to see more exciting plays. But defensively, I think it's definitely a detriment to them, to those guys.
Ro, I talked to a lot of different African-American young kids that you know, go play college football, and some of them, you know, get an opportunity to play in the next level in the NFL.
Yeah.
And what would you say is the biggest hurdle for African-American quarterbacks as it pertains to when you leave high school, getting to college, getting a real opportunity to start at a predominantly white university? And then leaving that situation and being able to go to the NFL and have success like a Deshaun Watson and a Russell Wilson of the world. And we're seeing way more African-American black quarterbacks be successful than ever before. What is the biggest hurdle, and how do kids get over those hurdles from high school to college to the pros?
It's a good question. I mean, I can answer it, because, I mean, hell, I went through some of those hurdles.
Right.
I think, man, and I can speak for myself, and I can speak for what I saw, right? Mm-hmm. For me, I'll give you an example. One day my mama called me when I was in New England, and I was like, all right, mama, holler at you later. I got to go to work.
Right.
And my mama said, where you work at? You know what I'm saying? So that's one of the biggest things. I know, for me, it was funny too. You know what I'm saying? But, like, you got to get out your mind, especially when you going from the high school to college, and I go in that order. High school to college, you got to understand that you don't know anything. You know what I mean? Like, you're coming into a new system, new area, you don't know anything. And then you have to understand, well, for me, I had to understand that I was a black quarterback, and I was going to be viewed differently.
Yep.
So certain things that white quarterbacks did, or way they act or carry themselves, I couldn't do the same thing.
Right.
You know what I mean? So That to me was the biggest adjustment in college, was just getting in, falling in line, but not falling in line to where you lose yourself, mm-hmm. but falling in line to where you understand, okay, I'm different. This position is different. This position is played predominantly by a certain guys, certain color guys. And so everything that I'm going to do here, I got to make sure I do it to the 10th. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Everything I do, I got to win every sprint. I got to make sure I'm in class. Like, everything I got to do, I got to do to the 10th. You know, and that was a difference from high school to college. And then also, you know, y'all know it, just not having nobody there to push. You got to self-motivate yourself.
Yep.
You know what I mean? Whereas, like, in the league, once you go from high school at the quarterback position to the NFL, first is understanding where you are in the totem pole, dog. Like, if you got drafted high, you got to understand what's expected of you. If you got drafted in the middle, you got to know what's expected of you. And then this is the other thing. Do not take that for granted, dog. Like, that's the biggest thing. Like, don't think that, okay, I'm going to get this next contract, or I'm going to do whatever this year, and I'm not. Like, take it as a real job. Take it as, you know what I mean? Like, I don't care if it's special teams, whatever it is. You just got to take it as serious as possible. And like my mama, like, it ain't, like, everybody think, because, you know, you're playing ball, you're playing. It ain't playing. Take it as serious, because there's big money in it. And that's the part about it. I didn't take it that seriously when my first year in. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I'm thinking, like, okay, I'm going to make it to the third contract, or I'm going to get my opportunity. And the other thing is this, too, especially for our position, don't think that an opportunity means in the game. Don't think that your shot is when you get thrown on the field to play.
Right.
Your shot may be when you get asked a question in the film room and you got to go in depth to describe that coverage that you just saw, that he just put you up on the board to see if you've been studying. You feel me? Mm-hmm. Like, dog, they got a story about one of my dudes that the coach gave him the tape to bring home to study. This one we had DVD, G. You know what I'm saying? To take home to study. Brought it back. Coach asked him, what, you know what I'm saying? How'd you look at it? What you think? Oh, coach, you know, I'm good. See, the DVD was blank, dog. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So it's stuff like that they do to you.
Mind games.
To see where your mental is, to see if you really going home doing what the hell you're supposed to do, because they putting this money in your pocket. So yeah, that's the biggest advice I can have to any black quarterbacks, bro, or just anybody going in the league. But from my position, and you never stop studying, dog. Like, you never stop studying. You never stop studying at my position. You never stop studying. I don't care. Dude, when I first got in the league, Tom was stamped already. I think he had one chip. I remember Tom calling me. This is when I was like, shit, bro, you got to get on your, you know what I'm saying? You got to get on your issue.
Tom Brady telling you
this. This man called me like 3:00 in the morning. He called me. Yeah, that's when I'm telling myself, like, if this man don't want Super Bowls, he calling me at 2:30 in the morning on a Wednesday night to ask me what the coverage is, because he's been up for 3 hours watching film, but he don't know what the double coverage is, whether it's 3 and 6, 2 and 5. He don't know what the combo coverage is, and he can't figure it out. He's been racking his brain for the last 2 hours trying to figure out. He called me like, Shaq, what you doing? I'm like, shit, 12, I'm asleep. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I'm asleep, but he up, but he the GOAT. You know, like, that's why I said with him, it's not a coincidence, or is it a fluke why he is or where he is. What that incident right there made me know that I don't work hard enough.
Right.
No. I remember coming into the locker room, I'm thinking I'm getting in there faster than Tom. I'm in there, it's like 6:00 in the morning. I'm in there. His whole locker is toe up. It's about 8 towels on the floor. It's drinks already made. It's breakfast. It's all that. Man, that boy been in there since like 4:00.
That's crazy.
It's crazy, dude. That's when I was like, I gotta change my attitude. Yeah. You know what I mean? My work ethic, dog, because it's not a fluke, bro. Like, that's why anybody talk about, you ain't gonna never hear me say nothing bad, because I know how he worked. The boy worked, dog.
I have a question for you. I want to piggyback kind of off of G question. Most time, and it's a sad thing, but it's, you know, perception is reality. When they see an African American quarterback, they automatically say like he's an athletic guy and all that stuff. How does it? You know, so they kind of try to do that with you a little bit until they honestly understood like this kid has an arm. You know, he doesn't, you know, just because he's black doesn't mean he's the next Randall Cunningham, you know, or how do a young kid coming out of high school shake that stigma of being an athletic quarterback and being just a quarterback?
I think that, you know, it just goes back to what they say about, it's like when you see a white cornerback. Right.
Right.
That's like athletic. That's this. They stamp them. So I think, and now they want an athletic quarterback that could do all the things and also throw the football. I think you just got to stick to your guns. Honestly, I think you got to stick to your gun. When I was coming out, I was getting recruited at defensive end and safety.
Damn.
Never played either one of them.
Wow.
You know what I mean? I never put my hand in the dirt a day in my life.
They did the same thing to Dak Prescott.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. And that's my guy. It's ridiculous. So you just got to stick to your guns, man. I know that's part of the reason why Dak didn't come to LSU. Didn't even consider LSU because they wanted to change him.
The tight end.
And it was a reason. Yeah, it was a reason. Like, Spurrier recruited me as a defensive end, dog. Like, I never even played. Right, rush the passer. I never did any of that. I was baffled by that. Like, I don't even understand it, but that's what you got to stick to your guns. They see your size and all that, and think they can make you into this and mold you into this, but you got to stick to your guns, man. But I think nowadays, I think it's easier, actually. I think it's easier for the guys because the guys are coming out and it's what they're looking for now. You know what I mean? Like, they're looking for guys that are big, strong, fast, that could change the game with their feet or their arms now. So it's a little bit easier for the black quarterbacks, as far as the mentality still hasn't changed, as far as whether or not you're smart or intelligent and stuff like that. That's still a question, I think, to the end of time that we're always going to get hit with. But the athletic part and the ability to throw and the ability to lead, they ain't going to question none of that.
There it is, y'all. Listen, listen, Ro. It's been a pleasure, man. It's been a pleasure having you on FanView Live. You came here and dropped some gems about Tom Brady, bro.
Definitely. Definitely. Definitely.
Yeah, dog. Boy, dog, man. For real. Dog. You know what I mean?
My last question for you, Ro, before I let you go. I've been following Ricky Collins since his ninth grade year at Woodlawn. And the progression I've seen from him every year, you know, a lot of college coaches that I have relationships with thought he was an elite talent, but had a problem with his release.
Yeah.
Watching him in Panama when you was coaching him up with F3 Elite. Yeah. And y'all got you and Ken do a great job with the organization, man. I've been paying attention to you guys from afar. And I really love the organization and the camaraderie I see from y'all 7-on-7 team. It's just not about 7-on-7 football, what you guys.
No, it's not, bro.
Right.
You know, we started this 7-on-7 league 3 years ago because we had teams that the bootleggers had excluded. Shout out to them. They started the organization out here and been doing a good job. So we started because we had kids. I was like, Coach, y'all should start one. And my son wanted to play in linebackers one, really, you know what I mean?
Right.
Coming to play with that because it's a quick guys game.
Mm-hmm.
So we started that. Man, it's way more than football, dude. Like, you know, these kids, our job and our message is to get these kids to college.
Yep.
Once we get them to college, then you got to do what you got to do from there. But it's more about teaching them how to be respectable, teaching them how to be men, teaching them how to conduct themselves when we go on trips, when we do certain things. It's spending time with them, dog. It's making sure that they ain't worrying about if we need y'all to make sure money's in the budget for them to take SATs and ACT classes and to take as many of them things as they need. So we don't want no kid to be like, yeah, Coach, I ain't take the SAT. But why you ain't take the SAT, dog? Like, I couldn't afford it, Coach. Nah, see, that's the time. Like, there should be no kid. I don't give a damn if you want to take the SAT 10 times in 3 years, man.
Right.
Like, that should not be an obstacle that stops you from going to college.
Right.
And
right.
It's just good things like that we try to put in play. Of course, when we go out to these tournaments, we want to bring that chip home now.
Yeah, that's first and
foremost every time. But
We don't care about that in the grand scheme of things. So we try to let these boys know there's a bigger picture. There's a bigger place than just here in Baton Rouge, than New Orleans, than this. There's a bigger thing out there called life, which y'all boys going to go through. So we try to do the best, G, to prepare them for that, man, and to just do right by people. Don't screw over people. Don't screw over yourself and give yourself a chance. A lot of these kids don't want to give themselves a chance. And now with NIL and all this, you got to understand that they watching y'all. Right. Your money could be impacted when you get ready to go to college. Y'all getting money when you go to college now.
Yep.
Well, I wish I had NIL.
Right. 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 But to finish my question pertaining to Ricky Collins, you know, a lot of college coaches was praising him, but they had a lot to say about his delivery. You know, you can kind of say he had a wind up. Watching him closely, when we played you guys in Panama, he's cleaned up a lot of that. I think Ricky's ceiling is extremely high. I've been on record saying this plenty of times. I don't care who got something to say about it. I think he's the best quarterback in the state for 2023.
Yeah, I'm with you.
I think he's the best quarterback in the state. I'm sorry. Just the way he prepares, his maturity, and his progression. You know, a lot of kids kind of stay the same. You don't really see them evolve, man, year in and year out.
Rick's been working. And this is the thing. We know what his arm talent is.
Well, yeah,
right?
No doubt.
And so what we've been working on is the steps to the delivery.
Yep.
You got me? So consistently carrying that ball up instead of having that ball around your waistline. So now you got to bring it up, which is another step. So if that, a lot of these kids think that when they say, oh, he got a quick release, they thinking like, oh, he throw the ball fast.
Right.
So I try to get Rick to understand it has nothing to do with that. It's the steps to the delivery. Yeah. So we got his delivery down to two steps, where it's carrying here, right in between the breastplate or a little bit slightly higher. And then it's just a whip delivery. It's no longer coming around like a clock. You got me?
Yep.
So now it's backing out. And don't get it twisted. Sometimes when he gets long and we got to go deep, he gets back to it a little bit. But, man, I'm right there with you, deep. Like, he's been working his behind off for 3 years, you know what I mean, to get better. But I'm going to tell you, the biggest thing about that dude, he is a tenacious, I mean, a tenacious competitor.
Yes,
dude.
Yes.
Like, that boy is, I'm telling my dog, when we go to tournaments, he don't care about, like, who we playing if they suck or who start. All he do is look at and be like, coach, which one of these is the top ranked teams out here? And he like, okay, I want to play against him. You know what I mean? So that's the thing with the kid. And the kid is super intelligent.
Super intelligent. And he's a three-sport athlete.
The best quarterback in the state.
Yeah.
I do. Yeah. That goes for Art. That goes for all of them. I ain't scared to tell you either. I firmly believe that. And it's not because I believe that certain quarterbacks want certain smoke. You feel me? Uh-huh. And I believe that some don't.
Yep.
Right? And I just like I believe in coaches, I don't believe Lincoln Riley wanted that smoke of this SEC. But I believe that 62-year-old little old man we just got want all that smoke.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And I think Ricky Collins is the same way. I put him up against anybody, anywhere.
No doubt. I kind of wanted to get your analysis on that, man, and see how you – I kind of knew what your answer was going to be, but I'm glad you was able to break it down, man, just, you know, from a progression standpoint and how he has gotten better and cleaned up a little of those technical issues.
He has.
Yep.
He has.
Bro, man, thank you for coming on FanView, man. Got to get you back on here again in the near future, talk some ball.
Absolutely, bro. Y'all do a good job, man. I appreciate y'all having me on, G.
No doubt. That's Rohan Davey, man. LSU, big time LSU standout and New England Patriot quarterback. Holla at your roof.
All right, buddy.
There it is, y'all. Listen, that man, he came out and said, listen, Tom Brady was studying film on coverages for 2 hours.
Yeah.
2 hours.
Yeah.
And called him up.
Yeah.
He like, I'm asleep.
Yep.
That goes to, you know, and let's talk about Tom Brady. Let's just
go into it.
Let's just go into it. Let's talk about Tom Brady's retirement. I think one of the biggest things I like to take from Tom Brady and his pro football career is that to me, him and a guy like Kobe Bryant, they made winning a skill. Mm-hmm. I love what they've done. They made it a know-how. I don't think when anybody look at Tom Brady's career, the most important, impressive thing, I know people are going to look at the 7 Super Bowls that he achieved and the 10 appearances, but the thing that sticks out to me more than anything, I don't think nobody's more prepared than Tom Brady for a game. I think what people don't understand is that when Drew Bledsoe went down, he made a decision to himself to let everybody know on that team and that organization that he ain't getting his job back.
Yep.
This job is over. This is my job from this point on, and there's no disrespect to Drew Bledsoe. That's the competitor in him. But the part that I think we got a chance to witness for our eyes is that he made winning become a skill. Some people think winning is something that happens to, playing the game. And I think he really made that to understand that it's a know-how. You have to know how to win. You have to prepare yourself each and every game and each and every time and opportunity to be the best prepared on the field. One of the reasons I love Kobe Bryant is because I think he was the most prepared. One of the reasons I love Floyd Mayweather is because I believe he's the most prepared. You get what I'm saying? The reason I love Usain Bolt, I believe not only did he just the fastest, but I think he was also the most prepared. Mm-hmm. And to me, when I watch Tom Brady, that's what I'm going to take away the most. I don't think I'm going to watch another player at his position approach the game in terms of being prepared is better than him. That's the part that sticks out to me more than anything. He made winning look like a skill. He made it a know-how. And I think that's the best thing I'm going to take away from the football. Now that a guy of this caliber has retired, I would prefer him to come back one more season and give me a TB12 tour, because I feel like a guy of that caliber requires a tour to call it quits. I feel like, I'm going to play one more season. I'm going to go to every stadium possible. We already know it's done. Whether we win a Super Bowl, we don't. But we all get a chance and opportunity. Mm-hmm. We're going to go watch him play. I'd love to have one more season for the people who dislike Tom Brady the most, where they came on down and say, we're not going to watch a guy of that caliber again. We're just going to come to the game just to make sure whether our team wins or lose or not, I got a chance to see Tom Brady the last time. I would have loved to see him play one more season. You led the league in passing time. You led the league in touchdown time. You could have gave him one more season. But greatness deserves time to be put on the shelf. And congratulations to Tom Brady.
Man, what can you see? When you talk about Tom Brady, 22 years, doing it how he did it, a 6th-round pick out of Michigan. When you see the clips of him at the NFL Combine, you have no idea that he is going to be the GOAT 1D.
Slow as molasses.
And I say this all the time. People always want to say somebody's the GOAT. I hate that.
They lose it too loose.
Every time you get on social media, he the GOAT. Everybody the GOAT. No, this is the GOAT. This is the GOAT. And I think people are losing sight of what the GOAT really means. Greatest of all time.
They lose it too loosely, G.
Right. Now, I don't agree with Stephen A. Smith when he said he thinks he's the greatest NFL player of all time. When I think of NFL player, I think about, a Lawrence Taylor, Jerry Rice, Randy Moss, Deion Sanders. I don't think about, because athleticism has to play a part into all of that. But he is the greatest quarterback to ever touch a pigskin. And what I respect most about Tom Brady is he didn't skip steps in his process.
Right.
He handled adversity well. Going all the way back to his days at Michigan, Tom Brady didn't play his first 2 years at Michigan. A lot of people don't know that.
Right.
He suffered from
anxiety. Brian Griese started.
Yeah, he suffered from anxiety, depression, was thinking about transferring. And even back then, he met with a psychiatrist and kind of was helping him cope with that anxiety of not, being able to play.
Right.
And he stuck it out. Then they brought Drew Henson in.
Yep.
Who they thought was going to be the next John Elway, the next Joe Montana, the next Dan Marino.
Yeah.
Tom Brady battled with Drew Henson, ultimately got a starting gig. I think his first year start, he was like all Big Ten. And then the next year, his senior, he killed it.
Yep.
And then he got picked in the 6th round.
Mm-hmm.
Had to go through some more adversity. Going behind, everybody was saying he was going to be a backup his whole career. What happens? Drew Bledsoe gets hurt. He waits his turn, though.
Right.
He waited his turn, went through that process. He didn't skip steps in that process.
Correct.
When he got his opportunity, just like Rohan Davey just talked about, when he got his opportunity, it wasn't when Drew Bledsoe went down.
No, it wasn't.
It was way before that.
Way before that.
Belichick put him through a test way before Drew Bledsoe went down. And when he got his opportunity, he ran with it.
He's the most prepared.
Won a Super Bowl, then won six more Super Bowls. Well, five more Super Bowls.
Yeah, with the Patriots.
Okay.
Competed in nine with them.
Right.
Nine.
And then you say, okay, my time has ran out in New England.
Yep.
I need another challenge. I need another opportunity to show people I am like that and that I don't need Belichick to hold that Lombardi trophy up.
Right.
What does he do? He goes to Tampa Bay.
Right.
And wins a Super Bowl in year one.
Year one. No mini camps. No OTAs.
I mean,
no preseason.
I mean, if that doesn't show you the greatness of Tom Brady, I just don't know what he has to do. And then this year, at 44 years old, he throws for what, 4,900 yards?
No, he threw over 5,000.
He threw for over 5,000 yards.
And led the league in touchdowns.
Over 40 touchdowns. Led the league in touchdowns. At 44 years old. I would have loved to see him continue playing. You know, he had said things like 2 years ago that he wanted to play until he was like 48.
Mm-hmm.
But he wants to leave out on top.
Yep.
And I respect that. And I think it's some more things that's going on inside the Tampa Bay organization that he probably doesn't want to put out to the public.
Yeah.
You know, as far as the cap situation, them being able to re-sign players back, and just a lot of commotion that went on with that team this year that he's probably not going to ever disclose, probably until he write a book 5-6 years from now.
Yeah.
So I think that really played a part into all of this. But all in all, you know, I'm glad I was able to grow up in that era and see him go through that pioneer stage and become the GOAT. And Tom Brady, I just don't see anybody coming close to what he's done until maybe another 15 to 20 years.
Coach Hen, what you got?
I ain't gonna say nothing bad today.
Of course. You know, you can't talk about that Michigan man bad. You know he went to the Wolverines, baby.
I ain't gonna say nothing bad today. I will say this. I don't think he's the most preparedness quarterback. I think that's Peyton. It comes from what the defense, the great defenders that played against him, will always say, your Ray Lewis, your Ed Reed. You know, when they say, like, hey, you know, your Troy Polamalu, just said the hardest guy to prepare for was Peyton, you know, to be. But I will give flowers where it's due. Tom, to me, is the most tenacious competitor I've probably seen at that position. No situation fazed him.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, football, you know, to me, like, football is a complementary sport. You know, you can't do it without. I think he probably will be the quarterback that goes to the Hall of Fame that did it with the least. Until he got to Tampa Bay, and we know that roster just was ridiculous. But you
and that one year with Randy Moss, no.
Yeah, that one year, but they didn't win it.
You know, when you think about years that they won the Super Bowl, you know, his leading receivers in one year was David Givens, Deion Branch, you know, Wells Welker,
David Patton, Julian Troy Brown was one of the first time.
Troy Brown's shoot 'em up, bang bang. Rob Gronkowski,
the shots,
the running backs, you know. You know, that just shows you the ingenious of him and the coachability of him to accept the system. Because people forget that Charlie.
Roll ice.
Volume went out. I think we might be having some technical difficulties.
Yeah.
Yeah,
there we go.
Okay. But like I said, people forget that, you know, Charlie Weiss was his first coordinator and stuff. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, he wanted that system. He wanted Josh McDaniels' system and all that stuff. Now, you know, it's some other stuff about it that, like, people will always question, you know, like, hey, the tuck room. You know, you take, you know, Michigan on Michigan crime, you know, hey, that might be another Super Bowl that he don't have. You know, like, it's part of the game. You know, it's just part of the game. You know, the deflate game will always be one and all that stuff.
And, you know, you can't, you know, as much as, you know, people will try to, you know, always wager time against Belichick, you can't take away the greatness of Belichick because Belichick's probably the greatest NFL coach, that we have had. But get the man his flowers, you know, just do. And I knew it was the end, like he was going to retire this year. I don't know how you guys thought about it. Super Bowl or not, I knew he was going to retire this year. Like it was 2 things that showed me. One, when he started the Man in the Mirror podcast, mm-hmm. and he was mm-hmm. just talking about the good days and, you know, kind of like reminiscent type deal,
right,
about all the stuff. And it was strictly all Patriots stuff. He said it was nothing about currently what was going on with him. And then two, it was like a couple of games against the Saints. It was like any game that he kind of got hit. That he got hit a lot, you know. We used to see Tom Brady get hit, like, and he's sitting there, he's fussing that off. I remember, like, when he was playing with the Patriots, he got hit. He's sitting there fussing that Matt Light, and then telling him, "Hey, pick me up." You know, like this time, like, you know, when he'll get hit, he'll just like kind of lay down. It was like, you know, like he has nothing else to prove. So, like, how much longer do I want to do this? You know, so that, like, when me and G was talking about it last week, like, it was like, to me, like, that's why I was like, hey, when I put those two things together, like, he done.
Yeah, Giselle said it's over, buddy. Come on, raise these kids with me.
I kind of want to rebuttal to what you said about Peyton Manning. You know, I have this conversation with a lot of my partners in our group message, and they always want to throw Peyton Manning next to Tom Brady. And to me, it's not close. Nah. If you want to talk about regular season, yeah, I'll give you that. But as it pertains to the playoffs, in the postseason, when it really matters, Tom Brady ain't on the same stratosphere, ain't on the same planet as Peyton Manning.
I didn't compare them. I just compared the word that – all I did was took the word that Fred used in the most preparedness of, like,
Peyton,
he's not the most prepared.
That bowl's not to be true. Because he's not, he don't look too prepared in the playoffs.
Tomato, tomato.
No.
I'm just saying. I mean, if you go back and look at Peyton Manning's playoff stats, or if you go back and look at his performances, it's not impressive like that to say we talking about him as arguably the best quarterback of all time. I think you are measured about what you do in the postseason. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying Peyton Manning is not an elite and a great quarterback of all time. But he's not on the same level as Tom Brady. 14-13 is your record in the postseason.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I'm not comparing them. I'm not comparing. I just took that word that he said.
I don't think Peyton Manning was more prepared than Tom Brady. I just don't.
I just don't. I, you know, like that's – I just – like I said, I took it from all of the great defensive players that we played that played the game against both of them, and they all, like, nobody said, like, they all said, like, even your guy Charles Woodson was hard to play against because he was more prepared.
I think his quarterback mind of how to play the position and how to see coverages. Yeah, people would make the assumption that Peyton Manning was
Peyton Manning was a better arm talent.
Yeah, but in terms of being prepared for four quarters of football to help win again, like I said, he made winning a skill set. It became a skill. It became a know-how. When it comes down to that, I don't think no one is more prepared to win a football game than Tom Brady.
And when people talk about, oh, Tom Brady had a defense, he had Belichick as a defensive mind. Okay, Peyton Manning had some of the best weapons that you will ever play with. Marvin Harrison, Dallas Clark, Reggie Wayne, Edgerrin James, Marshall Faulk. Like, he played with some elite, Joseph Addai. He had some really, really good offensive players. So, you know, I feel like it cancels out. And if Tom Brady had the weapons that Peyton Manning had all his career, man, his stats probably would be so enormous that nobody probably will ever break it. And I think that is, people lose sight of that. They always want to talk about he had a good defense. Yeah, he had a good defense, but who was he throwing to? Jermaine Wiggins?
Yeah.
Huh? Troy Brown?
Troy Brown. David Patton?
Come on, man. Come on.
I will say this, and like I can just feel if like if I was in the studio right Benjamin now, he'd just be looking at me. But I'm gonna say it, goddammit. I'm gonna say it. Because I ain't scared.
Go ahead.
You know, Tom Brady would probably be the I'm trying to think. Like he probably
please don't say nothing disrespectful.
No, I'm just being honest. Like he's gonna be like he's a first ballot Hall of Fame, no doubt. But he's when you take up quarterbacks outside of the Super Bowl and winning, you won't put him like up there like in an elite talent. Like he's gonna be like that first guy. Like he won't be that guy.
You talking about from just a talent standpoint?
Yeah.
Yeah, I get it.
Well, of course,
I get it.
Of course, you're gonna probably think of Dan Marino. You probably think of Brett Favre.
But guess what?
When you talk about elite talent, at the end of the day, he does. So it don't matter. But like. You know, when you start, like, think about it like this. We know Emmitt Smith had the most rushing yards. But yeah. when our generation think about running back, the first name that comes to mind is Barry Sanders. Both talent.
It's just like when you talk about Jerry Rice. Jerry Rice was the most talented receiver that you will see.
You think of Randy Moss.
You think about Randy Moss. You think about Megatron. You think about people like that. Right,
but when you talk about the greatest wide receiver, everybody all like that go out the window, and it comes back to Jerry Rice. That's what I'm saying. Like Tom Brady is going to be in that same situation when you talk about the greatest quarterback, like arm talent, all that other good shit, you know, out the window. It's going to come back to Tom Brady. But then when you like talk about like elite arm talent, you know, that's your Marinos, Paytons, Aaron Rodgers. You know, say those guys, but when it comes to greatest, all that's out the window is gonna come back to him.
But I'll say this: that one redeeming quality, and this is for sure, that Tom Brady has that Peyton Manning does not have when it pertains to the postseason, and that's that clutch gene, baby. That's that clutch gene. When it's time for the game to be decided by the quarterback position. Tom Brady gonna come through more often than not.
Yeah.
Well,
Peyton Manning is like, maybe.
There's an interception somewhere in there.
I'm not too confident. Tracy Porter, pick six, baby.
That's it. There's an INT somewhere.
To be honest with you, I honestly believe like that is the best line to describe those guys. Because look. I don't care what nobody say. Aaron Rodgers falls in that same category as Peyton Manning when it comes to that, because he's gonna lose it more than he's gonna win it. You know that clutch gene. Hell, Drew Brees doesn't even have the clutch gene.
He got it more than Peyton Manning.
You know, but it's gonna be Joe Montana, John Elway, and Tom Brady.
Yeah, the record supports it. But, you know, again, we got to move on. Moving on. Yeah. All this Brady talk, you know, the Michigan man, you know, we got to move on to more things to talk about. We got to talk about some of the head coaching hires in the NFL. Obviously, they started off with nine vacancies. Now we're down to five. For people who don't know, the Chicago Bears job has been filled. The Denver Broncos job has been filled. Let's see what else we got here. The Las Vegas Raiders job has been filled. And what other job? The New York Giants.
Mm-hmm. With the bowl from the Bills.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And there's still five jobs still vacant. The Saints, Vikings, Texans.
The Jaguars didn't hire anybody.
Jaguars and Vikings. And Dolphins. I'm sorry, the Dolphins. The Dolphins are still vacant. So they still got five vacancy jobs. What did y'all take of some of the hires that we've seen happen so far? And what is y'all take on Brian Flores filing a lawsuit against the league regarding the hiring process? Coach, I'm going to start with you.
I'll start with the Brian Flores thing. We've all talked about it. We knew the Rooney Rule was a Band-Aid at best. It was just something to do with. Now I commend them for starting the movement, but you know, as time passes,
you know, stuff got involved. I've been a firm believer. I've been talking about it for the past couple of years. I believe it should be a one-in-one rule. What I mean by that, for every non-minority person you interview for a position of GM or head coach, it should be a minority person being interviewed. It doesn't have to necessarily be African American, but it has to be
right.
A minority person. You know, that's just what it is. Because they're gonna do like for instance, when the Bills assistant GM got the GM job for the Giants, we knew that it was gonna be Brian Daigle. No, it makes sense. It honestly makes sense. That's somebody you work with. You understand him. When you starting something, you want to pull somebody that you know is qualified and somebody that you have a good relationship with already. I totally understand that. But and you should understand that going in for an interview. I just believe that. It was just caught up, you know, it just so happened to be one of the teams that he was interviewed for. And, you know, the text message from Belichick was icing on the cake to give him, you know, the ammunition to push forward with this. What I think he's doing is very bold to be young. Just think about things like this. He's young. And he's still in the height of career because, like, he still could have got a job, even if he would have got a job this hiring cycle, he would have damn sure got a job the next hiring cycle. But he sacrificed all of it to make a better way for more minority coaches. Because think about it, it's only two minority coaches out of 32 teams. That's Ron Rivera of the Washington Commandos. I mean, yeah, I think that's the name, Commandos, whatever. And Mike Tomlin of the Steelers.
Oh boy, there's another one. The guy for the Jets,
Robert Saleh. Okay, Saleh. So three. But three out of 32. That's bad. You know, that's not even 2% of your league. You know, so I feel as though that is good on him. Good on him because it's a chance that he just. Blacklisted himself for the betterment of the future. So you know, as far as the Brian Flores, as far as the coaching hires that was picked, I understand why Denver got the Packers offensive coordinator because their ultimate goal is to get Rodgers, so to make it, you know. To make it more attractive for him to come in, I understand that part. I understand the Giants hire. The one I'm kind of scratching my head about, honestly, is the Colts DC becoming the Bears head coach when you have a young, you know, we all know it, the quarterback is the cornerstone to your franchise, and when you have a young kid, at that position, you get a defensive-minded head coach. Like, we've seen that does not bode well. The last time we've seen it, the most recent, I want to say, was Jeff Fisher with Jared Goff.
Yep. And, it was horrible.
And that was just a disaster waiting to happen. The only way this works out good is if you bring in a transformative, you know, offensive mind as your offensive coordinator, but then how long would he stay? That's the issue. So it's a setback. It's a setup for me. And I can't remember the other the coach I hired that we talked about.
Man, you know, just looking at the whole landscape of the NFL right now and what's trending. Right. What's trending is having an offensive-minded coach as your head coach. That's what's trending right now in the NFL.
Agreed.
I thought Brian DeBoer was the number one hire out of all the hires, okay? And that didn't even include Eric Bieniemy. That's just my personal opinion. I thought DeBoer was – I thought
– For the Giants. I mean, for the Bills.
I felt like Bieniemy would have been a better culture fit for the Saints. But just – when I'm talking about the whole grand scheme of things as, you know, what they've accomplished and you know, body of work. I thought Brian DeBoer had the best body of work out of all of the coaching candidates.
Gotcha.
What he's done with the Buffalo Bills
and Josh Allen,
those 3-4 years that Josh Allen, when he came into the league, has been tremendous. Every year, you've seen improvement from Josh Allen. And I talk about this all the time. When I'm looking at a player, a coach, an organization, I'm always looking for progression, seeing how you evolve it every year. And you've seen that from the Bills offense every year Brian DeBoer was the OC.
Agreed.
Now he has Josh Allen looking like an MVP candidate. I think he's going to be an MVP at some point in his career. Hopefully he still has that. Hopefully that can still happen even though DeBoer is gone. I thought Josh McDaniels was a really good hire. I thought he should have been a dark horse for the Saints job. I know we talked about when he was with the Broncos, and you know it didn't end the way it should have ended. But I thought when he was with the Broncos, he was extremely young, he was extremely immature, and the Broncos just gave him too much power.
Correct.
You know, he was making personnel decisions. It was just too much. He was
too premature for that job.
Yeah, it was too much on him. Now he's with the Raiders. Now he could just focus in on coaching. And like we talked about last weekend, he's been under Belichick for the last 5-6 years.
See, he's been in Belichick for the majority of his career. Like,
yeah, but I'm saying he was with Belichick, left and went to the Broncos.
Then he had one stint at the Rams, then he came back and be the OC.
Right, right. So I think sometimes when you come back to somebody like Belichick and you've gotten older and matured, now you understand how you need to handle things within an organization.
Correct.
I thought that was a really good hire for the Raiders. Okay? So as it pertains to everybody else, Nathaniel Hackett, you didn't even call plays in Green Bay.
Why?
I mean, I know Aaron Rodgers is praising you because him and, you know, LaFleur got their little roof going on.
Right.
The Broncos, you put all your eggs in one basket because this man, Aaron Rodgers, came out and said he thinks he should be a head coach.
Right.
Now, if you don't land Aaron Rodgers, now what?
Now what?
So I just thought that was just a ridiculous hire. You know that's the only reason they hired him.
Yep.
Because of Aaron Rodgers. And they think they can get Aaron Rodgers. But, and the rest of the hires, I just feel like it's not even worth mentioning. So, Brian DeBoer, I think he was the number one hire out of all of the candidates. I think he's going to do a really good job with that Giants team.
Mm-hmm.
And he's going to have his work cut out for him with Daniel Jones.
Yes.
I think let me ask you this: do you think that he's probably in the best situation too? Because so like as far outside of the Raiders, because you know they got Waller, Edwards, Jacobs, and Carr. To me, like offensive wise, like he's set up. If especially if Saquon Barkley is healthy, but with Tony, Galladay, Ingram, you know. I think he's in the best situation.
Well, and then you got to think about this too. He's going into a division where
it's weak.
The Cowboys are probably going to be a good team again next year.
Correct,
I would imagine. Right,
right.
But the Redskins or the Commanders,
the Commanders, the Commanders,
the Washington Commanders, which is a ridiculous name by the way, and the Eagles. I just think that they're going to be an average or below average team going into next year.
Correct.
So,
to my two teams with no quarterbacks to me.
And they just don't have the pieces either.
Right.
Now, Washington has the pieces defensively.
Right.
Offensively, they got a ways to go.
Way to go.
You know, McLaren is really the only.
Him and Gibson are the only
two. Yeah, Gibson.
And Gibson's is okay, but he's not an elite
guy. But your quarterback is.
Yeah, and your quarterback is just, and your offensive line is just atrocious. So. In the Eagles, I just think that, you know, I like Jalen Hurts, and they got some pieces with, you know, even though Jalen Reagor has not panned out yet.
Right. They got Greg Ward.
The kid Watkins. You know, they got some little complimentary pieces. But
Devontae.
They got Devontae.
Yeah, Devontae Smith. But what I'm saying is they just don't have enough.
Right.
In my opinion. So I think the Bowl could be going into the Giants situation with this thing And he put himself in a situation to where they can win about 10 games next year. Now, will they win the division? I don't know. But I think he'll be fighting for a wild card spot in year one with the Giants because he's going to uplift that offensive side of the ball that much. And defensively, the Giants was really good last year. They was really good. So I think the Bowl was the best hire, and he's going to do way more of a
than Joe Judge.
Have way more of success than what Joe Judge had.
The only reason why
Judge got the job is because he was connected to Belichick. That's the only reason. Let's just keep it focused.
Yeah, Joe Judge shouldn't have been hired. No offense. I don't think the trend is offensive coordinators becoming head coaches. Yes. That's the trend.
Yes.
And I think that with Brian Flores and his lawsuit have gone, I think he has merit. I don't think he should have the interview for a job that was going to already be given to somebody else just so you could check off the Rooney Rule box. That's wrong, and I support his lawsuit for that happening to him, because that's starting to happen to a lot of people, especially minority coaches. They're just checking off the box, but they already have somebody in mind who they're going to make the decision and hire. And we all understand how business works. Everybody's gotten a job based upon relationships. Everyone's gotten a job being received. Hey, listen, I know this person, and I know this person. This is the person I want to bring in. Obviously, got to do some due diligence, but we know everyone's not being hired off of merit. We know a lot of people are being hired based upon the relationships they have. You look at 32 teams around the league, you got three minority coaches and the other 30, or right. 29, are Caucasian.
Right.
And a lot of times these guys just know how to – they have relationships, and that's no disrespect. But when you start looking at the grand scheme, I support his lawsuit and for him going forward, because he's about to get blacklisted. But that's the stand that he wants to take. Now, some of the remaining jobs that's left available, I think the Minnesota job is still attractive when you look at the offense over there. Where you have, you know, Kirk Cousins, you still have, you know, Devin Cook.
Dalvin Cook.
Yeah, you had Justin Jefferson. You got
Thielen.
You got an attractive team. They just need to get their defense back together, moving in that direction. I don't like the Bears hire at all. I just don't. I think that it's just
poor Justin Fields.
Poor
Justin Fields, man.
I don't like that situation for him at all because, again, you don't have somebody that – when you're trying to – you have a young quarterback. I think you need to pair him with the right OC and the right offensive mind to help develop him and bring him along. That's kind of the connection that's been happening, the quarterback and head coach connection. Bringing a higher defensive coach does not do justice for Justin Jefferson. Even when you're looking at the Jacksonville job, I think whoever they're going to hire is not official that it's Byron Leftwich, but I think Byron Leftwich is going to probably be the person for that job. But then when you go look at a team like Houston who has a lot of turmoil and you don't know what's going to happen with Deshaun Watson, I think he'll be traded. I think a guy like D'Amico Ryans works perfect. I think they got to bring a defensive player in. I think when you don't
Not on D'Amico.
You don't like D'Amico?
What's wrong with D'Amico?
1 year?
No, I'm not saying he should be high. I'm just saying what's wrong with it. What's wrong with him?
We're gonna give somebody control of an organization who just been a defensive coordinator for 1 year. It's like pretty much it goes back to the argument that G's made last week. You know, like to me, the reason why DeBose is a great hire, he got skin in the game. Like yeah. It wasn't like he didn't have one great offensive season and made it. The reason why Salva wasn't a good hire the previous year was it wasn't like he was just a DC for 1 year. It was three, four consistent good years, and it was a system that he built. D'Amico didn't build this system. It still is rivaled. It's a solid system.
Yeah,
but he just overtook it.
Yeah,
but I can rebuttal that with the two guys we're about to watch in the Super Bowl were OCs for 1 year.
The who?
Zach Taylor was not an OC for long. He was an OC for 1 year in Los Angeles, and he's the head coach of the Bengals, and they're in the Super Bowl. That goes the same for McVay. McVay was the OC for 1 year in Washington because Kyle Shanahan was the OC. He was OC for 1 year, and he got that Rams job. We about to watch two coaches who coached this 1 year, and they're both in the Super Bowl.
That's a good point.
Rebuttal is offense. They coach offense. Defense is totally different. It's easy.
Who wants to coach Houston?
I'm a defensive guy. It's easier to get the offense will always be ahead of the defense because your defense, you got to react. All right?
If the
lead of your team is strictly offense, it's going to be a whole lot easier. Defense, you're going to exclude the offense here. That's just what it is.
But so let me ask you a question. All the jobs that's left, which one's the worst job? They just fired a coach after one season. Who? What job is the most attractive? We all know that the Houston Texans job is the least attractive job that's left.
Yeah, I would not want that job.
I would not want that
I don't
job.
Even, and I know they came out and said Brian Flores is
a candidate.
A finalist.
Yeah.
Why would you want that job? They're going to set you up for failure.
Yeah.
And if anybody hires Brian Flores right now, they're only doing it because of what's going on with this lawsuit.
Right.
They're not.
Right.
You're not going to be set up for success. And they're gonna fire you in year two or year three at the most.
Right.
And just kind of going back to that topic, people have a problem with if you already have a strong indication that who you want to hire in your process, right?
Right.
I can relate to that. And I know this is different, but it's similar. When I've been at shoot circuit tryouts for basketball, AAU, mm-hmm. or with my 707 organization with Louisiana Elite.
Right.
Or if I've been to other people's tryouts, you already have a good idea who you're going to pick. You're just hoping these kids that come try out, somebody changes your mind. Somebody blows you away in the tryout. It's the same thing with these NFL coaching interviews.
Right.
When these coaches are coming, when they got these list of candidates, so if you got six candidates, you know it's one out of them six you like this. That's who I won't hire.
Mm-hmm.
That's who I won't hire. That's who we're going to plan to hire. And you interview the other five.
Right.
And just, you know, to do your due diligence and say, okay, let me see if one of these guys going to change my mind. Well, let's see if one of these guys just going to blow me away.
Correct.
And I think we got to be very mindful of just saying that Brian Flores has been wrongly done in these interviews. Now, the stuff about John Elway and them coming into the interview inebriated and kind of like, I think he said he was like 30 minutes late to the interview. Now, that's unacceptable.
An hour. And he said that he figured that they've been doing some drinking the night before.
That is totally unacceptable. That's letting me know there that you don't take me serious. And that's very disrespectful.
Right.
And so I'm not talking about that.
Right.
But as it pertains to an organization already having an indication on who they want to hire, right, you cannot feel no type of way about that.
Correct. They may have a relationship with that person.
And people like who they like. Look, before they start coming up with these candidates, who they going to hire, they already been talking, asking different people around the league, doing Zoom interviews with certain people, trying to figure out who they think is best fit for the organization. Okay? Now, Mr. Ross for the Miami Dolphins. Bro. If this is seemed to be true.
It's true.
That you was trying to get this man 100 bands to throw games. Just like Stephen A. said, you need to be revoked from being the Dolphins owner. You cannot own a team. You gonna jeopardize the integrity of competition. I hate everything about that.
We're not watching wrestling.
Right. We're not watching wrestling.
At that point in time, to me, you and the bookies got something going on.
Yeah, and
that can't be. That can't be.
I'm not going to say his name, but I have a good friend of mine that currently plays in the NFL, and he's been playing in the NFL for five or six years. And he told me this about 3 or 4 years ago. He said, this goes for the NFL and the NBA. He said, in the NFL, there are 32 teams. He said, out of the 32 teams, maybe 5 or 4 teams in the league is really trying to win. He said, the other 28 is just trying to make sure they profit every year. He said, they don't really care about winning.
I've been trying to tell y'all this for years. It's a business.
It's only about 4 organizations that really cares about winning. And when he told me that, I didn't want to believe it.
Right.
I didn't want to accept it.
Right.
Because I'm such a competitor and I love football and I love basketball and I love seeing teams compete on Sundays and Thursdays and Mondays.
Right.
And I just don't want to believe it. But as it pertains to this Brian Flores situation, when an owner comes out and is telling you to intentionally throw games, this goes back to what my boy said that's in the league.
Mm-hmm.
So this just clearly lets me know that this is very true. And owners in the league don't care about winning.
They care about that bottom line.
They care about that bottom line and making sure they profit at the end of the year. And well, I mean, listen, bro, this puts a dark, dark cloud over the Shield, whether people won't like it or not. And I think Mr. Ross, he donates millions of dollars to this. What's the organization he donates money to every year?
It's not the Miracle League. It's but it's something.
It's something doing with injustice to black people and helping out African Americans and minorities and stuff like that. Smokescreen. Smokescreen.
But let's think about this.
Call donation for a
reason. I don't know why we shocked about it, because
I'm shocked that you would pay your head coach $100K to throw a game. I'm shocked about that. I'm not shocked about everything else. I'm shocked about that.
No, but I'm talking about like the drawing the game part. Because remember when he got when before they hired Brian Flores, like Adam Scheffler said it, Martin should say it, and it's like people forget about it. They was trying to tank for Tua.
Mm-hmm.
He got hired the year that Tua was going into the draft.
Mm-hmm.
So that was part, like that was the plan all along. So it doesn't shock me. It shocks me that he was incentivized for it. That's
going too far.
But I can see he being set up for it. Like, hey, we're not going after this free agent. Now we're not going to do this. Now we're not going to, like, I can see him making it toxic to work and to get what you're trying to get accomplished. That I can see. But like to actually say, hey, for $100K, you know, you're gonna lose the game. And this let me know, like, cause I don't know Brian Flores personally at all. But this let me know that it was true. I met Hugh Jackson a couple of times. I met Tony Dungy a couple of times.
Mm-hmm.
Lovie Smith a couple of times. For them to immediately come back and say, that's not unheard of.
That's not uncommon.
And like they literally put themselves out there. And you know where there's smoke, there's fire, because there's a lot of people who just didn't have the courage to do what Brian Flores, or just are not in the position to make the stand that Brian Flores did. This is my number one question. But won't set out their foot.
This is a big question that I have with Brian Flores. That happened back in 2019.
With Denver.
Yeah. With the Denver situation and with the Dolphins situation, huh? The Dolphins situation happened 19 too, huh? Or 20?
Yeah.
19?
19. Right? It's his first year.
Why do you wait till now to say that? You should have put in your resignation then and came out with all this. I just, the timing of it, I don't like.
I would agree with the timing.
If Bill Belichick doesn't send those text messages to him thinking that he's Brian DeBoer, he don't come out and say all this.
He don't file a lawsuit either.
Why you don't come out back then and say what's going on and file a lawsuit? Why you wait till three years later?
I think it's simply because he had the job.
Okay. We're on FanView Live.
Right.
You know, the producer tells us, okay, look, Hen, look, Fred, look, G, I want y'all to go on the L and say some racial stuff. And if y'all do it, man, I'll give y'all boys $20,000. Guess what I'm going to tell you, Fred, and the producer? I'm going to holler at you.
Peace.
I'm going to holler at you. Peace. I don't want to be nowhere part of that. And I know what people are going to say. Well, man, he don't want to leave all that money on the table. They're setting you up for failure. Ain't nothing about success going to come out of that. Right. I'm sorry. And so that's my only thing about this whole situation with Brian Flores. Why did you wait 3 years to come out and say all this?
The only thing that does bother him.
Because he got fired because he was winning. Like, he was like, he was like, okay, like
basically, like, basically,
I think he had the Miami, like, he took the Broncos interview to not burn bridge. He already knew, like he was offered the Miami spot after his final, like, he had his final interview already,
right?
He had a first interview at Denver. And let's think about it, like, do you want to work for in Miami or Denver? In a, you know, like Denver is more attractive. So, like, of course you accept that interview. This is not burning a bridge, because, you know, John Elway is a powerful person
yeah.
for the Shield. Right. So you take that not to burn no bridges. But so he had that in his back pocket. He probably understood like I wasn't gonna be successful year one anyway. Take it. But to get fired the way he got fired, after Dave was the one who said, "Hey, we gonna tank for Tua." Then they was like, "Hey man, Tua is not getting it done. Let's see if we can get Deshaun Watson." And then you keep winning, and like now there's like they blew it on. Well, look, it wasn't us. The coach didn't like you. So now we're gonna let you the coach go since Tua is starting to play up to his capability. So now it's like if it's being drawn back on me, I gotta protect myself. And now I'm seeing I'm not getting a fair shake for these jobs. Now let me open the bag, so to speak, and whatever happens, happens.
My only thing about it is this, and we're gonna move on because we got to get more to get into. My only issue with this, the timing of it, what G is talking about. My only issue is that when other minority candidates start getting hired for these other five remaining jobs, I don't want this lawsuit to overshadow the achievements of these head coaches. When Byron Leftwich, if he gets a job, let's say he gets the Jacksonville job, I don't want to feel like they hired him because of this Rooney Rule or whatever the case may be. I think he's earned the job that he's got. If let's just say D'Amico Ryans becomes the next coach for the Houston Texans, I don't want this lawsuit to be the narrative of why these guys were hired for the jobs that they got that they're going to get hired for.
Brian Flores shouldn't even want to take any of these jobs because you're only getting it's a pity party,
right? Yeah, and that's the only issue I have about the timing of this lawsuit. I don't want to make the narrative look like everything's going to be connected to Brian Flores' lawsuit if a minority coach gets hired for one of these five remaining jobs. That's the only real issue I have.
Quick question before we shift. If not now, then when?
What you mean?
That's the problem.
What you mean? Like, what you mean?
Like, no, I'm just.
You done muted yourself again.
Can y'all hear me?
Yeah.
I can hear you now.
I say if not now, then when? Like, what would be the perfect time for him to
to me, like, you know, he also trying to inspire change. So like it's no perfect time to do this. So like if not now, look, I'm just asking y'all because y'all saying y'all don't like the timing of it.
The time was back in 2019.
Yeah, yeah. He should have been did it. Once you start seeing that kind of stuff going on within an organization, you should already know, like, man, I'm not going to be set up to be successful in this
situation.
That's
the time to do it.
Like, I gotta come out now. Listen, if I'm Brian Flores, I wouldn't even want coaching the NFL no more.
Yeah.
That's just me. I wouldn't even want coaching the NFL.
You're not trying to play the politics of what's going on.
No.
So that's just – the only issue I have with it that I don't want his lawsuit being connected to guys who are getting hired of minority coaches. I don't want it to connect.
And then Brian Belichick texts him thinking he's Brian DeBoer. Like, that is absurd. Brian Belichick, I need you to put in your phone white Brian, black Brian. That's what I need you to do, Brian Belichick. That's what I need you to do. Come on, Belichick. Come on, man. You're texting the wrong damn Brian.
Get better.
I mean, it spilled the beans.
Because he worked for him. He worked, so he knew the right Brian he was texting.
I don't think he did, bro.
Man,
I really don't think he did.
Purpose,
can you put last name in that Bill Belichick?
No, put white Brian, black Brian. That's what you put. That's how you solve all that.
You're bad.com.
Hell, Belichick. You've been in the game too long.
You're bad. But listen.
He did it on purpose, man.
Yeah. Hey, man. You know, Bill Belichick bought that mess. Listen, but moving on. We got to get into signing day. National signing day happened last week. Yesterday. National signing day has happened yesterday. LSU has moved themselves up the ranks with some of the signings they have. And Texas A&M comes in at number one overall. What is y'all take on National Signing Day and some of the guys who decide to sign with particular schools where they decide to go to? What is y'all take on National Signing Day?
What you got, Hen? Let me hit.
I'm happy with the LSU signing class. I know Perkins was their number one. Like, we talk about board all the time. Perkins was their number one guy. Like, right. after Walker Howard and Campbell, Will Campbell, Perkins was they guy, was they guy. And they, and ultimately, in, like, G knows it better than me, like, if you could come away with your top three guys in the class, you feel successful. You know, losing Ogeron and, you know, and be able to come together within, like less than a month to put together the rest of the class that they did, is significant. You know, I, you know, hats off to them. I knew Danny Lewis wasn't like cheating, like he knows a person. I just from the outside looking in, just from the coaches, just coach talk, you know, I knew Danny wasn't going to LSU. When the Bama, like G said it perfectly on Twitter, it's Bama. When the Bama I know that's where he's going, especially with his name, Billingsley from Chicago, with him transferring out of Bama. It's like it's an open spot right now. Jacoby, I think once Jacoby had decommitted and Ogeron was gone, I think it was like Aaron Anderson. It just Jacoby just didn't say nothing. It was like that was the relationship that he had. And then on top of that, Corey had left too. So it's like I lose my two people. I'm not going there. And I don't think I think the Travon Citizen kid, I think it was like a last ditch effort, late push, too little, too late. I honestly thought Billy Napier was gonna get him. It shocked me that he went to Miami. But you know, Jimbo has been consistently putting together a good class since he's been in the SEC. It just doesn't show up on the field.
Yeah. I thought the Harold Perkins signee was significant for this class.
Right.
I think Harold Perkins, man, is probably going to play in year one. I think he'll rotate in at the beginning of the season. I think he will have a chance to start at some point throughout the season. I think he's that good, man. Losing Trevante Citizen, I thought was big because you got Noah Kane coming in from Penn State, you know, he's a really, really good running back to go along with John Emery.
Right.
But you always want that young back that's coming up behind some veterans like that.
Right.
You know what I mean? And you didn't get Le'Veon Moss. He signed with A&M. And you don't get Trevante Citizen. I thought that was big. Okay? I think you will see, because I think LSU still has about three or four spots left.
They have four.
Four. So I could see them getting a kid out the transfer portal. Yeah. Another kid out the transfer portal to solidify that running back room. Tight end, you got Mason Taylor coming in, who was the son of Jason Taylor, the former Miami Dolphin. I think he's a good player, but they're going to have to go get another tight end.
Right.
Not getting Danny Lewis, I thought was really, really big. I thought it was coming down to, for my sources, it was 50-50 between Florida and LSU. All right? I don't know what happened in these 2 days. I got that news on Sunday, and then he signs with Bama. So, and if you know anything about signing, they lead him to signing day. Things can change quickly. And I know you know all about that, Big Hen, as it pertains to Ismael Shops on signing day.
Why
I was there.
That, man?
I was there. It was so much drama. I felt like I was in a soap opera. All right? And then when they, as it pertains to Jacoby Matthews, I thought that Jacoby was going to come to LSU. From what my sources told me, that morning, he was coming to LSU.
Whew.
And around his signing was for 6 o'clock, and around about 3:30,
Jimbo.
I got a call
Jimbo.
That said, he ain't going to LSU no more. He going to A&M.
Jimbo.
So,
Jimbo.
These kind of things always happen leading up to signing day or on signing day. I've had kids tell me they made their mind up at the podium.
When them lights come on.
You know,
ESPN
once
film.
They get ready to talk, they just like, they plan it through their head. They like, okay, Miami. Okay, Florida. Okay, LSU. I've had kids tell me that.
Right.
So, but all in all, I think for year one, I thought Brian Kelly did address some needs. He did a great job in the transfer portal. And like I say, the Harold Perkins signing was big time. I think we're going to look back 2 years from now and say, man, Hal Perkins is one of the best defensive players in the country. So,
the ability is there.
And like we just talked about, they got four spots left, so I think you still be able to go fill them voids at running back, at tight end. And I think they should probably go get another interior lineman on the defensive side of the ball.
Listen, man, when it comes to signing day, man, I enjoy it. I love it. I like to see where these kids decide to pick colleges and where they decide to go. A&M did a very much of a splash, but I'm with Jai Eugene on this one here. Listen, they got the number one recruit classes to go 8-4. Maybe 9-3.
We'll see.
We won't see A&M in the SEC championship. They're not going to be there. Bama and Georgia are going to probably duke it out again. So when it comes down to it, you got to commend Saban for getting Danny Lewis coming to Louisiana. Mm-hmm. And still recruiting and still getting some of the kids to come on. He got what Aaron Anstey. Now he got Danny Lewis. He got what three or four total recruits out of Louisiana.
Shaz.
Pete Golden has to get his flowers. All right. Think about this. They got four of the top offensive players in Louisiana. Danny Lewis, Kendrick Law, Shaz Preston, and Aaron Anderson.
Four.
That is ridiculous.
Four.
That's ridiculous. Bama just finds a way to come in this state and get the elite of the elite every year.
Yeah. Now, to LSU credit, they've done a phenomenal job in the transfer portal. Obviously, you know, they get Hal Perkins. They also get the corner, Jalen, out of Texas. Jalen,
He got two last names.
Yeah. That kid there, I think he's, you know, going to be a big part of this class when you start looking back at it. Overall, a lot of these kids, you know, in terms of signing here right now, we're going to be following a lot of these kids, and the truth of the matter is you got to figure one-third is going to transfer. One-third. I'm looking at what A&M did, and I'm telling y'all right now about 10 to 12 of those kids are going to be there next year. They'll be in the transfer portal come December.
Well, I don't know because Texas A&M got the best NIL going on
I don't disagree with that.
But I can tell you this from what my sources are telling me down there in Baton Rouge. Brian Kelly met with 75 business owners in Baton Rouge on yesterday. They gonna get it figured out. They gonna get it figured out soon, just like Rohan Davey just talked about earlier in this show. They gonna get this thing figured out because right now, A&M, Bama, and even Florida are ahead of the game as it pertains to the NIL right now. And I think that you know Brian Kelly, like I say, I know it was Napier's first year too, but I think Napier was more educated. And ahead of the curve because he was getting NIL stuff set up in Lafayette before he even left UL. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of players was telling me and people on the staff was saying he had different people coming in and doing seminars and educating the players on NIL and what was to come in the future. So Napier has been ahead of the curve with that. So Florida's going to be all right. Now Brian Kelly and them just got to catch up.
Right.
But another thing, that was something that Ed was weak at. You know, Ed is not a business. No, I'm not saying not business minded, but like the branding part of it, that's not
his strength.
Won't coach. He just won't coach and lay up. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And you know, so like that put to me like that put LSU as a whole because, and y'all know it. Even if it's a predominantly basketball school, your football program sets the tone
for
the athletic program at your school. So if they behind the ball on it, then just the athletics situation will be behind the ball on it. Now you had Brian, his first thing to come into it wasn't NIL. It was like the NIL stuff was like what like maybe fifth or sixth on his to-do list. The first thing was complete get a staff. Second thing was get kids in. Third day was, you know, set the culture, set the tone. You know, mm-hmm. so like now, you know, it's up to the NIL is on the table right now. It like you said, it's gonna get done, but right now, until it's established, you will always be behind the Texas A&M, the Floridas, the Texas, USC, teams, you know,
Georgia.
Schools that's been getting what you know, contrary to popular belief, you know, Georgia NIL situation is not that good,
but they're still in the top five in terms of recruiting.
Yeah, but they've been that since Kirby Smart's been there. So you know, talent is not going to be an issue at most of your SEC. Hell, Kentucky always is in the top 20, but is it going to produce on the field? You know, that's just, you know, just solely speaking on the NIL, once LSU get that situated, then people will start transferring from a Texas A&M type situation. But it's hard to leave that situation when it's just set up for you.
LSU currently right now, they have the 13th ranked recruiting class in the country, fourth in the SEC. And you know, a lot of people that I know that's diehard LSU fans, a lot of them was butthurt that they wasn't in the top 10. And
you got to give Brian Kelly credit for
this is year one. And he got some critical pieces in his class. You know, I thought that Walker Howard and Will Campbell, I thought as long as he got them in the fold in this class, a lot of the other kids was going to fall in line.
Correct.
And that's what you saw happen. Even though you didn't, you know, Trevante Citizen left and Jacoby Matthews left and Le'Veon Moss, you still had the Quincy Wiggins of the world and people like that stayed. Emory Jones, Bo Bordelon, you know, all those kind of kids still stayed and stayed true to LSU. But my question to you, Hen, is, who is somebody in this 2022 class for LSU that might not be a popular name, so to speak, in this class, but you think will have an impact and be, you know, one of the better players that come out of this class when we look back 2 years from now?
And I'm not just saying this because we interviewed him, but I think Latarius Welsh is that kid.
Y'all, I was thinking the same thing.
not a nationally known guy, but like we talked about this a couple of weeks ago, him, the ability of him coming off of that, like there's no pressure on him right now, so to speak. So like if I felt like I would have said a different name had we not got Joe Fusha, had we not got Gardner, had we not got
Greg Brooks
and all these, you know, guys that could come, that's coming in play right now. He doesn't have to rush himself off of the injury that he got in week five. I want to say week five or four. You know, so now he can actually recover, learn behind guys who's been successful in the SEC and in college ball, and then, you know, he's going to be that. I'm not saying Tyrann Mathieu, but his story is kind of like Tyrann Mathieu. The only difference is he wasn't a two-star guy. He worked his way to get there. You know, and by him being a hard worker, I think, you know, is going to be that guy that, like, when it's all said and done, like, I think Quincy Wiggins is going to be a big-time guy. It depends, like, and I think one of the reasons why we kind of low right now, nobody knows what the offense or defense is going to look like. So you actually got to see that in motion. But pass rusher is one of those situations where is you know, who you line up next to, and, you know, you can it could change everything for you. So I think Quincy would be all right. Harold Perkins, because would be all right. But I think Terrence Welsh, being able to sit behind Brooks and all those guys, come back healthy, and then hit it. Cause like we said, I don't think Jordan Allen's gonna play this year. Like, he might be another guy. He certainly got the skill set to do it. But then I also, like Fred just said, I see he might be one of those kids that's on a 1/3. Cause let's say the defense, you know, is going like crazy, and then you start getting the LSU recruits that you normally get.
You get lost.
He might be one of the guys like, I don't want to sit, I want to play and go, so to speak.
Yeah. I'm with you on the Latarius Welch. I love everything about him. I love his competitive nature. He has the length, the measurables, the eye discipline, the ball skills. He has it all. Once he gets healthy, I think Latarius is going to be the next elite corner to come out of LSU. But I think Dave Johnson said this last week, when me and him was talking, and we were just talking about, you know, being where you at in recruiting classes, if you're top 20, if you're top 15, top 10. And you know what Coach Dave said? He said, man, look, we don't pay attention to all that because you don't know how good that class is until two to three years from now. And that is so true. You know, everybody getting all excited about what A&M has.
What I'm saying.
And I'm not saying they don't have no elite players, but right. some players come to college that's five stars, number three in the country, and they get complacent.
Correct.
And they don't pan out.
Right.
So it remains to be seen on who actually is going to have a better class. Who's going to develop these kids? Who's going to create a culture? And if Brian Kelly does anything close to what he did at Cincinnati, Central Michigan, Grand Valley State, and Notre Dame, this class is going to be all right.
It comes down to, again, we're operating now in college football. There's a free agency period. And that free agency period is a very attractive time with guys like Caleb Williams, who just left Oklahoma and go to USC to follow Lincoln Riley. You're going to start getting a lot of guys who came in here signing with some of these classes. Feel like they're not getting playing time. Feel like they wasn't getting the opportunity to compete for a position. Feeling some type of way about, you know, when they got recruited and then when they finally got here, it was not what they expected. You're going to have guys just transfer. And I think what Brian Kelly has done, if he can get this team 9-3, you know, not necessarily competing for, you know, the SEC championship, but look very competitive early on, I think overall you're going to have kids who signed in this recruiting class for the majority standpoint stay. But a lot of kids, I look at A&M, I'm saying, I'm looking at a lot of kids. Oh, they sound a lot of kids. Yeah, a lot of kids going to be in the semi free agency. It's just a matter about what fit it is, what job you're coming to competing for, and when can you get an opportunity to play. So a lot of these kids who you see signing with some schools, they may, like Greg Brooks, who went to Arkansas. He didn't stay, you know, he transferred. Now he's at LSU. You know, a guy like Kyron Lacy, who started off at Louisiana Lafayette, now he's at LSU. So we're going to start seeing that more often. But I think in terms of the recruiting class, I think, like what G said, it's going to take a couple of years. It's going to come down to how many kids are you able to keep and retain overall, and how many kids can be able to compete for positions in certain jobs. LSU needs a tight end and they need an additional running back. You know, but I like overall what Brian Kelly had to do this early, this fast, within 2 months.
Yeah. And what you're going to see, too, once spring practice comes.
And Jim Harbaugh's back, baby. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about the Wolverines. We'll be coming back.
I throw the M's up, baby, and I throw them up. And once spring practice comes along and kids at other schools and even at LSU kind of start figuring out what he had on the depth chart and how things are going to go, you're going to see some more kids hit the portal.
Yep.
So
yep.
I think what LSU's probably going to do is hold those four spots. Don't reach.
Don't reach.
Wait till the spring is over and see who hits the portal, and you fill those four spots where you need. Running back, another defensive lineman, and possibly a quarterback, too. Possibly another quarterback. Be on the lookout for that.
That's a possibility.
Let me ask y'all this. With the transfer portal being what it is now, do y'all add the transfers into the incoming recruiting class?
Yes.
And count that, like, so, like, the 2022 class, like, we know Walker Howard, also, y'all count Greg Brooks, Kyron
yep.
Lacy,
yep.
and Miguel yep. Card, Gardner, and part of that class?
Yep. Yes, yep. I do. Yep. And that's why I say, like, with the transfers they got coming in, along with that class, I thought he did a really good job in year one. I think he did a really good job in year one.
And I think he did a good job overall in keeping guys like, what is the receiver that we have, that LSU has?
Keyshawn Boutte.
Keyshawn Boutte. It's important for him to keep a guy of that caliber.
Yeah.
To me, he's the best receiver in college football. He makes the biggest plays. He makes the most explosive plays that you can look for in the office. So for what Brian Kelly had to do, not just talking about the recruiting class, but just keeping certain players like Mason Smith decided to retain, you know, stay in-house. You know, so when you're looking at coming in as a head coach, who are you trying to keep? Some guys had to go. Eli Riggs went to Alabama. That's cool. You know what I mean? You can't keep everybody. But he was able to keep some guys who are going to make an impact on this team and the guys that he's able to get in. So, yeah, I do count transfers a part of that class.
I want to see the NCAA put some guidelines on the transfer portal. I just think you should not be able to transfer within the conference. I don't like that. I don't like it. It's too much that comes with
free agency, GSportz.
Nah, man. You shouldn't be able to transfer within the conference. You know, I like the fact that the kids are able to transfer, but you should not be able to. If you transfer within the conference,
you should graduate.
You got to sit out a year.
Or have you graduated?
No.
What you mean?
No.
If a kid graduated, he spent 3 years and he actually graduated, I think he should be able to transfer where he wants to. I can understand your position.
I think you should have to transfer outside of the conference. I like it. And then as it pertains to the NIL, they gonna have to put some guidelines on it because it's too chaotic right now.
Yeah, it's Wild Wild West.
It's a lot happening.
It's a Wild Wild West, baby.
It's a lot going on. You gotta put some guidelines on this thing too, man. And you know, I still think the NCAA is a year or two away to really having they hands on this and really having a hold of this thing. Because if you don't get this thing with some guidelines, it's gonna turn into a damn circus, which it kind of already did. So I just hope the NCAA, they're up there. They're seeing all the things that's transpiring in college football and in college basketball. And I hope they're coming up with a plan to make sure there's some simple guidelines for the NIL and for this transfer portal to make this college football. Because they at the end of the day, they're all amateurs.
Right.
And I do think they should get paid. But they have to have certain guidelines in place going forward so this thing don't get out of hand.
I agree with that. I think it should, like, one of the first stipulations is you have to have a certain GPA to qualify for the NIL. Because, like, at the end of the day, you're still a student athlete first.
I like that.
So, like,
I like that.
So, like, that right there, like, because at the end of the day, like, yeah, I'd be super happy when I can sign for, you know, sign at a school. And I'm super happy when I see them play. But I'm more happy when I see that kid walk across the stage, because now, no matter, because one day, like, what they gotta understand, one day you're not invincible no more. One day you always gonna find, it's always gonna be somebody bigger, stronger, faster, somebody that you're just not gonna be able to beat athletically, and your body is gonna eventually quit on you. But that piece of paper stands forever. You know, so I think, you know, putting like setting the tone right off the bat, like, hey. Like if you don't got no 2.28, you can't have an NIL.
Yeah, I'll at least say a 2.5. I think you need to have a 2.5.
Nah, man, you know how easy it is to get 2.5?
That's a C average. You're passing. They don't stop you from getting a degree with a 2.5. You get a degree.
You can't join a fraternity with a 2.5. You at least need a 2.75 to join a fraternity.
Hey, man. We talking fraternity standards or NIL standards?
Yeah. It's all network, man. Get your brother 2.8. It's easy. You got, what's the excuse for, this is the thing, what's the excuse not to get a 2.8? All these schools now have tutoring services, like where you don't have to leave your facility. You only have to leave your facility to go to class, and then you back at your facility. They feed you. You can eat whatever you want now. You can work out whenever you want. The meetings are at the facility, and they have tutors there that don't leave until the last kid leaves. So what's the excuse not getting a 2.8?
Man, you was a college student, man. You know the excuse for getting a 2.8.
I'm just saying. they didn't have no NIL when I was in college either.
Those are true too.
Right then. you knew how to get a refund check.
Of course. You needed a 2.0. You want that Pell Grant? You want that? You want that Pell Grant? 2.0 it is, brother.
How get an extra dollar?
Yeah, you know, yeah. I don't disagree with not having a GPA requirement attached to the NIL. But we gotta get ready to wrap up, Coach Hen. This was a great show, man. Thanks. Shouts out to Rohan Davey for coming in, stopping on FanView Live, dropping some gems about, you know, LSU. Tom Brady, you know, just everything about his experience of being a pro quarterback and a time of why he decided to even come to LSU. We big shout out to Rohan Davey, man. Listen, you're welcome here anytime and every time, Rohan. We deeply, deeply, deeply appreciate it. My man, Coach Hurricane, ain't want to put conditions on these kids. You 2G Sports, I won't put conditions on these kids. Let them kids.
Hey,
free market.
I tell you what, you need to put conditions on. The way I told Jeremiah Gray that the Bengals was going to beat the Chiefs and the Rams were going to beat the 49ers. And goddamn it, here we are, baby.
Finally, I'm wrong.
You might be wrong again. Joe Burrow might get an MVP, baby. You might be wrong again.
Finally, I'm wrong.
Might be wrong again.
Goddamn. It's about damn time. About damn time I'm wrong. I've been Nostradamus all year. I've been Nostradamus all year.
In these playoffs, I was only wrong one time.
Hey. Sometimes salt look like sugar. That's our show. That's our show. That's our show. That's our show. Producer, go ahead and wrap it up. Start the theme music. There you go.
There you go.
Appreciate it.
Appreciate it. Who I can't hear you no more. I can't hear you. He's drawing it out. You, he can't, he's drawing it out. I can't hear you. I can't hear you here. I can't hear you.
Hey, you feel me knocking? Let me in.
The day of the Geechee is over.
Listen up. Your customers, our listeners, could be hearing about your business right now. Yeah, right now. Don't miss out on the opportunity to advertise with NewOrleansTalkNetwork.com. Call our business department today at 504-475-4793 to hear about our great rates. NewOrleansTalkNetwork.com. We provide the people, you provide the business.
Subscribe to FanView Live on YouTube for more premium content. And follow GSportz on Twitter, G_Sports with a Z on the end. And follow me on Instagram, _GSportz with a Z on the end.
Listen, I'm that boy Fred. Listen, you can also find me on Twitter at @BFredJones. You can also find me on IG at _BFredJones. For more exclusive content, subscribe to all our social media platforms, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and Twitter. You can also find FanView Live on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and Stitcher.